Hi guys, this is Mina and welcome to my channel. This video is a continuation of the topic SQL Constraint. In my previous video, we learned about the NOT NULL and UNIQUE constraints. We mentioned that SQL constraints are used to specify rules for the data that we have in our tables. In today's video, we are going to learn about primary keys. So primary key is another type of SQL constraint. So when primary keys are specified on a column in a table, they uniquely identify the records within that table. And for that to happen, primary key constraints uses a combination of the NOT NULL and UNIQUE constraints. And also, when primary key is specified on a column within a table, it helps to easily retrieve records from that table. Primary keys help to easily retrieve records from a table by creating a clustered index. So every primary key when created on a table creates a clustered index. So why are clustered indexes important? They are important because they help to speed up queries in database management system. And without indexes, the database management system will have to scan all the records within a table in order to retrieve records. And that is what is usually referred to as table scanning. So imagine if you have over 10 million records, the database management system has to scan all these records. You realize that it will lead to slow performance of your queries. So primary keys are important. And even if you don't want to specify a primary key on your table, you can create a clustered index by using the create index syntax. We have talked about clustered indexes, but basically there are two main types of indexes within SQL Server. They are the clustered index that we've just talked about and non-clustered index. While a clustered index helps to speed up queries, and they do so by reordering the records within that table. And because a table can be sorted in only one way, there can only be one clustered index in a table. So once you create a primary key and the clustered index is created together with it, you do not need to create another clustered index because it's not going to work. However, you can create more than one non-clustered index on your table. All these definitions seem abstract, but let's move on to a SQL Server Management Studio and try this out. Here in my SQL Server Management Studio, I have a database created called Demo. In this database, I'm going to create a table called People. So I'm going to go to New Query and paste the syntax here. If you want to learn more about how to create tables within SQL Server Management Studio, feel free to click on the link above or in the description section. So I'm just going to go ahead and execute this command. I'll refresh the database and open it up to tables. My table has been created. In this table, I did not specify any column as primary key. So I'm just going to demonstrate to you how primary keys helps to uniquely identify records in a table and also to enforce the NOT NULL and UNIQUE constraints, as well as help to reorder the records within the table for faster queries retrieval. So here I'm going to insert some record into the table, make this record a null record. And because there is no primary key on this table, a null value can be entered into this column. And also because of the absence of primary key on the table, we can enter duplicate records. As you may know, this may be a data quality issue. 10 rows has been inserted into the table. So let's select all records from table people and see this. See, the record has been inserted. They are just arranged the way we entered them. However, this ordering will immediately change if we specify primary key on this table. The way we can enforce primary key constraint on a table is to specify it at the time of table creation or if the table has been already created, as in this case, then we can alter to include the primary key. However, because of the records that we've entered here, the null record as well as duplicate records, the alter statement is not going to work unless we clean up this data. We would first have to remove duplicate records and null records from this table. So let's try to alter it and see the kind of error that we will get. So I'm just going to alter the table people and add primary key to the ID field. Again, because of this null value and duplicate records, this syntax, although it looks right, would not work. Cannot define primary key constraint on a nullable column in table paper. So in order to fix this, we can update the record in our table. So we can update the table people and set the ID column to 8, where the ID is null. Okay, so once we run this command and select from the table, our null record will be gone. Now that we have updated the record to remove null, let's add the not null constraint to this column. So I'm going to alter table people and alter colon ID, which is an integer field, to not null. Alter colon ID. So we are altering table people, altering colon ID, which is an integer field, to not null. There we go. So right now the table has been set to be not null, and there are no null records in there as well. So now that the table is set to not null, remember the primary key enforces both not null and unique constraint. So this altering to add primary key will still not work because this table is still not unique and we have duplicate records in there. Basically, this error means that we cannot create unique index on this table because of the duplicate record. So again, we can update a record to remove duplicate before we can execute the primary key alter statement. So let's set ID equals 1, where the name field is, say, Ben equals Ben. So this syntax means that we want to change the ID field of this record here to 1. So this is where the name equals Ben. So set the ID here to 1, where the name in this row is Ben. I did not use ID because there are two of these records here. So if I say update people's table, set ID equals 1, where ID equals 3, both of these IDs will be changed to 1. So I'm just gonna run this code. One row has been affected. If I select, you see that the Ben field has been updated to 1. There we have it. So now that we've made sure that our table has no duplicate records and no null records, we can execute this command to add primary key to our table. Command completed successfully. So this is how you can enforce primary key on a table that has already been created and has records. And if I select from the people's table, you'll realize that the records have been sorted in ascending order. This is because of the clustered index associated with primary key, which helps to sort the records and also for faster query retrievals. If there were no records within our table, it would have been easier to just execute this command without having to update any record. So for instance, if I create another table called people1 without inserting any record, I can simply alter the table people 1 to add the not null constraint, and alter the table people 1 to add the primary key. No need to update any records because people 1 doesn't have any record. This is so much work if you don't initially specify your table as a primary key. Now, the easiest way for you to specify primary key is at the time of table creation. In order to do that, write a syntax to create a table. So this time I'm going to create table people 2. And then what I can do here is to add the primary key keyword here. And that's it. I will create a primary key on this table people 2. Every primary key constraint has a name. So let me show you. Refresh, go to table people 2. And if we go to keys, we see that primary key here has been created. It has, the system gives it a name. So if you simply specify primary key here, system will give it a name. However, you can redefine the primary key to give it a name that you want. So let me drop this table. Drop table people 2. And for me to give a name to my primary key, I just need to type the constraint syntax. So constraint, what name do you want to give to the primary key? Usually you want to prefix it with PK, which stands for primary key, because there are other constraints and they should all have a prefix so that you can easily differentiate the different keys that you have on your table or different constraints that you have on your table. So the constraint name, the naming convention that I prefer to use is to, after the prefix, specify the name of the table and then the colon that the key is setting on. So I have constraint name. And so what constraint is it? It's a primary key constraint. And what colon is it on? It's on the ID colon. Okay, so after writing this syntax, it's giving me an error. That's because I have another primary key specified here, so I need to delete it. I can only have one primary key on the colon because primary key will create a clustered index that will sort the records within that table, and there can only be one sort order. So you cannot have more than one primary key. You cannot have more than one clustered index. And by the way, primary key will create that clustered index, so you don't need to recreate a clustered index. So if I execute this command, this time my primary key will have a unique name that was specified by me. And that's pk_people_id. There we go. So if I refresh this table and go to tables, people 2, you'd see that this is the ID colon that has a key here. That's a primary key symbol. And if I go to keys, now I have a unique slick name that I have control over. Now if you want to drop a primary key constraint, you can write the syntax alter table people 2 and then drop constraint, the name of the constraint people 2, there, and execute. Now we don't have any primary key on this table. We can only have one primary key on that table. However, if you still want to make any of these columns unique, then you can use the unique constraint. So for instance, I can create another constraint here. The name of the constraint, unique_table_name. I'm gonna make the name field unique, and it's a unique. And which colon do I want to make unique? It's the name colon. Drop table people 2. Now if I execute this command, I'll have both primary key and unique constraint created on this table. However, because of the primary key, the ID field will not accept null, but the name field will accept null. So let's refresh people 2 and see. Go to keys. So we have a unique key on the name field and then primary key on the ID field. So this is just a brief introduction about primary keys and the benefits of having primary keys in a table. I hope I've demystified the conception about primary keys. And please let me know in the comments if you have any concerns or if there is any other thing you know about primary keys you'd like to share with us, let us know. Thank you so much for watching this video and see you in my next one. Bye-bye.